I'm the last speaker today, then I will finish at some point. And first I will start, thank you the organizers, Carlos and David, for inviting me to be able to explain part of the research that I'm doing, but also I try to make it a little bit more general, this talk, to explain to the to all of you what are the advances that we have obtained by applying sequencing, and I put it environmental sequencing in microbial ecology. And I start always with this picture of the sea because this is our main group. And I also, listening the last talk, I realized that we are doing similar approaches of understanding communities as the last speaker presented, but we are totally forced to do it. It's not something that we can choose that let's apply environmental sequencing. We have to do it because we are working with microbes. Then I put here a very general slide to point out the importance of microbes in so many different disciplines. They're very important in ecology because they are main contributors of biomass activity and diversity. They are the main starrings of evolution in the origin of life. Much of the evolution has happened in the microbial size organisms. And they're very important in medicine, of course, as factors of diseases, but also as a symbionts helping our human bodies. And they are very important in biotechnology, even though sometimes the three humans didn't know, but they have been involved in the food industry for millennia, and also in the pharmaceutical industry and other processes. Then microbes, and in fact microbes, how do we define them? Then it's an operational definition. Those are the organisms that we cannot see. And depending on your eye, that may change, but I think that the border is 0.2 microns. 2.2 millimeters, then 200 microns. Then this is a picture of the oceans, of the earth and the oceans, and this is a composite of the chlorophyll values both on sea and land, and this is an average of 3 years that has been obtained by satellites. and it shows how everything that happens here with the colors, this is not low chlorophyll values, here are high chlorophyll values, and everything, this is, the responsibles for this chlorophyll in the oceans are the microbes. And estimations about primary production says that half of the primary production on Earth is done on the sea and the other half on land. And in fact, the who are doing this primary production in the sea are microbes. They are the phytoplankton. They are small, normally cellular cells. They have a wide range of sizes, from very, very small, and the size of 0.6 microns, Procolorococcus, to large diatoms, several hundred microns. And also the abundance on the sea can be very abundant, can be 10 to the 5 cells per milliliter, or can depend, or the abundance depends on a little bit on the cell size of the specific group. Then phytoplankton is very important for the ocean, of course. But bacteria are also very important in the marine plankton. Then I put here a few numbers just to highlight the importance of bacteria. Then the abundance are 10 to the 6 bacteria per milliliter, then 1 million bacteria of individuals, of organisms, in 1 milliliter of water, mostly water. If you make an estimate of the biomass of this component in the sea, it may range from 30 to 100% the biomass of the phytoplankton. And also bacterial production is it's also a significant part of the primary production. And this component in the sea, they double approximately doubling time is 1 to 10 days. And I'm putting here a few dates about how the knowledge on marine bacteria has evolved. And until this date, people knew that there were bacteria on the sea, but they could not be very well quantified. Then I would say that at 77, there was the first advances in epifluorescence microscopy to put and highlight that there are many bacteria. There are many bacteria on seawater. A few years later, investigations with radio tracers they could highlight that they were very active. Not only they accounted for an important biomass, but they were very active, and also that. The question was, if there are many and they are growing fast, what happens with this biomass that is producing? Then the mortality was identified as being grazed by very small predators that were also unknown at that time, and this is the date for that. Then in the sea, I have shown the phytoplankton, also the bacteria, but also there are the small protists, the small heterotrophic protists, that they are the main grazers of bacteria. And again, they are eukaryotes. Then here there are no prokaryotes, the grazers are eukaryotes. Very unicellular, colorless, they are heterotrophic, they have flagella, very small, most of them are between 1 and 3 microns, then really they are at the very limit of the eukaryotic cell. And again, the abundance could be 1,000 cells per milliliter. And basically, this is a very, very simplified cartoon of the trophic food webs in the ocean. And here, this is what would have been known as the classical food web, where there is phytoplankton, primary producers, being eaten by zooplankton, and those being eaten by fishes. That was the classical food web. But then there is another path of energy in marine systems, where part of the primary production is released as dissolved organic matter, and this dissolved organic matter is the food for heterotrophic bacteria, who are eaten by heterotrophic flagellates, and those are again incorporated in the classical food web. Then, and this is what it's called, the microbial food web. Then, that's a little bit strong, but I think we can say that the microbes are the engines of the sea. And in fact, what is true is that they regulate the pathways of fluxes and organic matter and material in the oceans. And also they participate in all biogeochemical cycles, including the carbon cycle with the trophic food webs, but also the nitrogen cycle, the sulfur cycle. Then they are really very important for the system. Then, given their importance, a very simple question. Who are they? What is the biodiversity of this component? Which species form these assemblages? And this very simple question, in fact, is not so trivial. It's not so easy to address. One thing what natural biologists naturalists have done is to identify things by morphology, to look at them. Then if we do that to try to look at microbes, and that you need a microscope, of course, but for instance, bacteria, heterotrophic bacteria, you see that this is an epifluorescence image of heterotrophic bacteria, and all of them, they look the same. Then you cannot not really apply a morphological criteria to identify them. And then what has been done for many years, for the 20th century mostly, has been to isolate bacteria on pure culture. And then from the pure culture, you have a lot of cells and you can make a biometabolical test, and then you can put a name to a strain that has been isolated from the environment. But then what happened is that when you compare the number of bacteria that you can calculate from plate counting by culturing with the number of bacteria that you observe by microscopy, there is the numbers that doesn't fit. And this is what has been called the great plate count anomaly, meaning that, for instance, in marine seawater, up to 99% of the cells that you see by microscopy cannot be cultured. Then really culturing is a problem. You cannot pretend to assess the biodiversity of a natural community by culturing its members, because many members doesn't want to grow in culture. And this is what brings us to the molecular approach, that we need this molecular approach to identify and to answer and address this simple question, who are they? And this is why I said at the beginning, this is not our election. There is no other way that we can address this question. We really need the bare metal sequencing. Then I'm going to organize the talk in three different steps. And in the first step, I will present what we have learned by using just a single gene from from a community of many different organisms. And this is what we call it, targeting a single gene. Then which gene to choose that can be compared among the whole tree of life, then the gene to use is the one that codifies for the small subunit, ribosomal DNA. And this is the tree of life composed by three different big domains, bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. and that was proposed back in the 1990. And this is the gene that we are going to use to identify the biodiversity of microbes in our seawater samples. And the approach to go to do, it's going to be what is explained in this flow, meaning that we start with microbes that are contained in water, dispersed in water. Then we have first to start concentrating these microbes to obtain the microbiomass that we can handle, and that's done normally by just filtration. Then the next step would be to extract the DNA, and then the next step is to target the gene that we want to use for identification, which is the small subunit ribosomal DNA, by PCR. And then once you have the PCR products, make a standard clone library and sequence several clones. And that has been what has been done initially to identify these organisms. Then the first study of this approach, targeted marine bacteria, that was published by Steve Giovannoni in 1990. And I'm putting here some results of this study. Those are a phylogenetic tree of bacteria. And in yellow, there are the sequences obtained in this study. And I put here 12 sequences, because those are the sequences that are presented in this study. It was a paper published in Nature, and that gives a glimpse how much we have changed with the sequencing. But even having only 12 sequences, that study was seminal. It was changing totally what was expected, because the main result from this study is that there were many, many lineages that were sequenced that didn't belong to anything that was known before. They were totally novel lineages. And also, already in the first study, there is this sequence here, which is called SARI-11, that has been a very popular group. This is, I think we saw this morning one slide about Pelagibacter ubique. Pelagibacter now is the only cultured member of this clade, the SARI-11. Then that was published in the first study, and after a few years, then you can see, that this SARI-11 clade, which was uncultured until 2002, accounts for one quarter of the clones of marine bacteria in many, you put many studies together, but also it accounts for a very, very large fraction of cells of marine bacterioplankton. Then, and this is done, I just put 35%, but this is a number, but many cells, and this is done because from the environmental sequence, you can design a phylogenetic probe that you can use by microscopy to count the cells using this specific probe against this particular lineage. Then you can really close the circle to be able to, a sequence that is uncultured and it's unknown, you can at least see the organism by fish. Then I think this slide, this figure shows how much have we learned also by environmental sequencing at the level of high rank taxonomy. Then before environmental sequencing, there were 12 large phyla or different phylogenetic groups that.
Yeah, these are the problems when we have live things, so I apologize.
Can I ask a question? Yes. When it comes to the difference between the 26% and the 35%? Yeah. SAR-11 is 26% of the RNA clones, but 35%
of the cells. Well, there are two different approaches, and you don't need to find the same percentages. Then, you have to do that for the first assemblage first. That was a collection of values from different studies. But even if you do at the same study, you don't expect to find the same. Clone libraries are based on PCR, and there are PCR biases. But also, there is the copy number of the operon, which can vary a lot between organisms. Then that's. But this is why it's so important to make the fish. Because initially you get an idea of sequences, and with the fish you can identify organisms and cells. Now it's fine, no? Okay. So then, in this graph, if we count the number of phyla that are known for bacteria and archaea, in 87 there were 12. Phyla of bacteria and two of archaea, and all of them were cultured, because this is how we knew them. We only knew what was cultured. But with environmental sequence, you see that now there are 12 groups that are known just by environmental sequences, and groups that are still uncultured, and one group in archaea. And the groups that are known by culture, they are also increasing, because I mean, culturing is very important. Then people make a lot of effort to get things into culture. And that is developing until now. In 2007, there are 30 different fillers, you see 12 to 30, that are known because they have, there is some culture representative, but there are more than 100 phyla of bacteria that are known only by the sequences. And well, with archaea, it's not so extreme. So using this graph with the different domains of life, then this approach was very successful for investigating bacteria. Then 2 years later, it was applied the same approach to investigate if there were marine archaea. And in fact, what was known at, until this point is that archaea lived only in extreme environments, and there are the ones that live at high temperature, and this is a hot spring. Others live at high salinity, and the halophiles, and others are methanogens, live in anoxic environments. Then, I mean, you didn't expect to find, you shouldn't find archaea in the environment, but yet with this environmental sequencing, that the two groups were identified, and again, using fish to quantify the real number of cells, one of these groups appears to be very 20% of the plankton as an average or different layers. And also, I mean, there is some specific ecological role that are conducted by this group of organisms. And then there is still one domain to be investigated, and that was done, in fact, more than 10 years later than for bacteria and archaea. And in fact, I think that was because somehow the scientists didn't expect to find new things within eukarya, because eukarya are us, and copepods and diatoms and so on. But then if you take a look on eukaryotes, microorganisms living on the sea, traditionally they have been classified in three size classes, the microplankton, nanoplankton, and picoplankton. And you see a few pictures of the organisms in each size class. And one thing that is very obvious here is that you can identify them for sure to the phylogenetic group that they belong, the microplankton, and also probably if you are very good taxonomists, you can identify the species. But when you are decreasing in size, then nanoplankton, and especially in the picoplankton, which are cells very, very small, 2 microns, 3 microns, 1 micron, then when you get an image, you almost don't know anything. Then there was really a problem to identify. I mean, the same problem that happened with archaea, with bacteria and archaea, could theoretically apply to the picoplankton or picoeukaryotes. Then I'm putting here a summary of the clones that have been obtained in these studies, analyzing the 18S ribosomal DNA of marine samples. And here is the number of clones, and here the different phylogenetic groups. And this is the percentage of groups. And if you see these groups here, those are the supergroups that we saw in the last talk, that all eukaryotes are organized in a few supergroups. And the number can change from 6 to 8, depending how you organize them. And among these 8 supergroups, in 2 of them, there is a small line that goes to animals, ametazoans, another line that goes to land plants. But all the diversity of eukaryotes basically is protist. Then all these groups are represented here in marine samples. Then there is a large diversity of marine picoeukaryotes that we could also see because this sequencing. And another thing that it was obvious from this graph is that there is these groups that you see the name, MALF, MAST, those are codes that we put to group of sequences that didn't belong to anything, to any place. Then we could really do not identify them, and they also make novel lineages. And I'm putting here a tree with stramenopiles to show an example of that. And this is the group that I have been working. It's the MAST, we call them MAST, marine stramenopiles. They account for 6% of the clones in environmental surveys. And these are all the stramenopiles groups. And here there are groups that they have a chlorophyll. And here there are the diatoms, pelagophytes, things, chrysophytes, which are quite well known. And all these gray boxes are groups that are heterotrophs, and they are also known because you can culture them or because you can isolate them from nature. And all these clades here that you see in red are novel clades that we found by environmental sequencing. Then you see that there are many different things in different places and novel groups that appear between populating the stramenopile tree of life. And one of these groups, we have worked a lot on that, MAS4, and by fish, we have seen that is a small heterotrophic flagellate, 2-3 microns, one of the smallest. It's widely distributed and abundant in all the samples that we look, we find it, and the abundance can be between 10 and 100 cells per milliliter, but it's everywhere. We have make experiments to identify that it's an inactive bacterial grazer, and also that accounts for almost 10% of the community of grazers in marine samples. Then this is another group that was unknown before, and it's a group to work with. We put at the same level than SAR11. It's the SAR11 of the heterotrophic protist. Then, if we evaluate the clone library's results, I would say that they have been very, very nice to identify novel lineages. And I also would say that has been very, very useful to prepare very robust phylogenies. But what is very obvious is that it doesn't have enough sequences. Then normally they have been done by Sanger sequencing. Then you have a clone library and you choose 100 clones, so you can choose 1,000 if you are very courageous, but normally it doesn't choose 1,000. And you get these sequences. And this cartoon, it's an image of what is expected to be the distribution of abundance and taxa for microbial assemblages. And basically, microbial assemblages, and this is what empirically has been measured, there are a few taxa that are very abundant, and then there is a long tail of taxa that are very rare. Meaning that with this distribution of rank abundance, if you work with clone libraries, you may expect to find this abundant part of the graph, but you don't expect to find this part here. Then really we need something that is similar to clone libraries, still targeting a single gene, but we can access to the rare part here, the rare biosphere. And basically this is what the next generation sequencing is affording. It's allowing us to access this part of the rare biosphere. And accessing this part of the rare biosphere, we will be able to have fair estimates of bacterial or microbial richness and diversity, because really we are going to cover everything which is in the sample. Then having a good estimate of diversity, we can have a good tools to compare assemblages, because before comparing two assemblages with few data, you have a lot of problems of differences because undersampling. And also it's like a new field to explore what is the meaning of this rare taxa, why they are rare. If they are rare because they are not growing or because they are happy being rare and working in this low abundance mode. Then I'm just commenting that within the initiative of the Census of Marine Life, there was an initiative that was called the International Census of Marine Microbes. And in this program that was launched, I think, in 2005, many groups in the world participated, providing samples, and these samples were sequenced in Butzhol. And these are the different locations for the samples. Most of them were for bacteria, some of them were for protists. And I mean, in a recent review, they just put a few numbers of the how many species, and these species between brackets, you should expect in a liter of seawater. And those are the numbers, 20,000 bacterial species and around 2,000 archaea and protist species. And also in this review, they compare all the samples using all the data that has been obtained using this next generation sequencing. And basically, this part here are all the samples that they derive from sediments. All here, the blue samples are the samples that belong from marine seawater. And also, marine seawater is divided by samples that they come from open sea and coastal samples. Then it provides like a way to organize the samples. We have been also participating in one of these projects using next generation sequencing, 454. To study the protist diversity in European coastal waters. And again, focusing in the mass 4 lineage, we could, in this project, we were analyzing different size fractions. We were analyzing DNA and RNA extracts, meaning the genomes or the ribosomes. And for this group, it was obvious that it was really in the very small size fraction. This is what we expected by microscopy. And also, it was a similar percentage of reads in the DNA and RNA analysis, meaning that they seem to be active, but not more than the rest of the community. Then we could use this data to compare the presence of this group in the different sampling sites. For instance, it was not so many that is in the Black Sea. And also we could use the sequences to investigate the phylogeny of this group. With previous data, we have seen that this group, basically, even being so abundant and distributed, it was formed by five different clades, only five clades. And then with the pyrosequencing, we just recover the same five clades. Then we arrive to the extent of the diversity of this group. Okay, now this is what, just by looking a single gene, I think we have learned a lot about the biodiversity of marine microbes. Then the second part of the talk is what would we learn about not targeting a single gene, but targeting all the genes from the community, from the microbial assemblage. And this is what it's called microbial metagenomics. Then that would be to study directly the genetic material from environmental samples with the idea to access genes of everything which is there. And I said before, most of what is there is uncultured. Then it's the only way to access to the genes of a culture of organisms. Then with these genes, you can infer metabolic pathways and infer the physiological properties of these organisms. And with that, you can obtain a functional profile of a community that can tell you how this community is working, which genes are being found in the community, and also to obtain these profiles to compare different communities. Then this microbial metagenomics has had quite a long story. And basically, this is, again, the pipeline of the approach, then from the organisms, biomass, the extraction of DNA, and here directly to sequence. Then the first metagenomics projects were done with a back library approach. And this is a more or less a scheme of the back library approach. Basically, it's to extract very gently the DNA to obtain very big pieces and clone these big pieces. And that sounds strange now in this nowadays, but I think that was a very nice approach because you could obtain continuous stretches of DNA, and also you can study operon organization in organisms. Then I am putting here an example of the first application of this back library approach. And in one study, Odette Beja, when he was postdocing with Ed DeLong, they analyzed one fragment that was 130 kb. And in this fragment, they found the gene of an uncultured bacteria. And in the same fragment, they found another gene, which was a rhodopsin, that is like a pigment. Then that was, with this pigment, they could make an activity test, and they put the sequence in a vector and make it express, and they desynthesize a protein that could act, and they could see what this pigment was doing for the genome. And basically, they identify a light-dependent proton pump, was pumping protons through the membrane to use the light to save energy and to create ATP for these cells. Then they discover by metagenomics a new process of utilization of light that was totally unpredictable. And also at that point, they claim very strongly that it was very nice that you discovered this project in one bacteria that it is uncultured, which is a gamma proteobacteria that was uncultured. Now we know that the proteorhodopsins are everywhere in almost all bacterial lineages. But at that point was also an important point. It's uncultured, and still we can identify this process. Then after this period with the back library, it came the whole genome shotgun sequencing, and that was, I mean, the main in this case, the extraction doesn't have to be gentle. Then you break the DNA in pieces, but still of a few kilobases, and then you clone these pieces and sequence each one of these clones. And of course, this approach was initiated by Craig Venter, analyzing the metagenomics of a few samples in the Sargasso Sea, and the number of sequences increased to millions, and they identify also millions of new genes, and you can categorize all the genes in different functions that are important for bacteria. And also the proteorhodopsins that was found before, and it was one gene, and I remember people were trying to make primers to study the diversity of proteorhodopsins in environmental sample, and then it came this work by metagenomics and made all these efforts useless because they found almost 800 different proteorhodopsins by metagenomics. Then you don't have to target a single gene, you just have to look at the metagenomics and see the diversity of this protein. And here I'm putting also another example just to exemplify how this work on functional profiling can be done. Then this is different functional processes for different metagenomes, and then you can just organize the samples according to the functions that theoretically can be found in these samples. Then obviously now metagenomics is entering the next generation sequencing field. And this, I mean, it's what has to be done because it's so promising at the sequencing level. And there are studies doing that. Eh? It's not that, I mean, I'm not presenting the data because it's more or less, they try to compare communities, they try to find processes. It's more or less the same thing, kind of things that you can do. But I'm going to present here two projects that we are participating. One is a Spanish project, it's the Malaspina cruise. And this cruise finished last summer. It was cruising the oceans during 7 months. Well, this is the path. And during this path, microbial metagenomics was a very important issue. Then samples were collected at several stations, at several depths, at several size fractions, and also they are going to be processed by DNA and by rDNA. And this analysis, it's going to be done by Illumina. And then we will see how we can digest this data. But this is something that is going to happen. Another project that we are somehow involved is the TARA expedition, and that was a 3 years cruise with a small ship. Also around the world, and also they are collecting samples for metagenomics at only two depths, several size fractions as well, I think DNA and RNA, and somehow, I mean, they are going to be quite comparable, and they are going to provide a lot of metagenomic information and many other aspects. Okay. And then I'm starting the last part of my talk. Then we have seen the data that we get just targeting a single gene, the data that we can get can this very promising targeting all the genes from the community. And here, what we are I'm going to present is the data that we can get targeting single individuals and the genomes of single individuals. And that's something that seemed as impossible a few years ago, but then now it's something that it's attainable by basically flow cytometry, because they are single individuals, but they are microbes. They're very small. You cannot handle them by hand. You cannot pick one and put each one in a different place. Then these single genomes, this is the process. Basically, you start with a sample, and then with a flow cytometer, you can separate cell by cell and put in a plate with some liquid. You can put a drop with one cell. That can be one bacteria, that can be one protist. And then once you have this cell, you amplify, well, you make the analysis of the cell and whole genome amplification by multiple displacement analysis in general. And then once you have this amplification, you can target a single loci. And in the project that I'm working, we target the 18S ribosomal DNA to identify who was the cell that fell down in the plate. And then if you like it, you can make the whole genome and reconstruct as much as you can. And again, obviously, this genome reconstruction is going to be done by next-generation sequencing, probably by Illumina. And what we can learn about that? Then we are going to sequence cells that they are the ones that dominate in the assemblage, that you cannot culture them normally. And then you can get the content of things that aren't cultured and that are totally unknown. You can say the gene content, the genome organization. You can make multi-gene phylogenies to put things that are unknown in a better phylogenetic context. You can study population genetics. You can see cell-to-cell interactions in this cell. If there are cells that coexist in the same cell, if the protists have a bacteria and symbiont, you can try to analyze these things. Or if a bacteria of a protist was eating a specific bacteria, perhaps it's going to be still on the single cell. And also you can use this information for metagenomic mapping. And basically to use this cell that you know where it comes from to interpret the metagenomic reads, as it has been done with cultures, but in this case, it's the genome of one thing that is not culture. Then this is one example of one of the first papers using this approach. This is a tree from the small subunit ribosomal DNA of picobiliphites. And picobiliphites was a group of proteins that was detected by environmental sequencing. And you can see here how it has no any culture representative, and it's quite far from anything else. The first paper was to present it, identify it, and saying, well, probably it goes here. Nobody really knows what is the phylogenetic placement of this group. Then with this approach, you can get many more genes, and you can improve the phylogenetic reconstruction of this group. This is, again, preoccupied. And you see all the position in the eukaryotic tree of life. This is one of the things that you can do with these amplified genomes. You can also use this approach to investigate protein diversity and also to get a collection of sacs of genomes from the environment. And I'm showing here a project that we are currently doing in the context of the TAR expedition. And here is several samples that have been collected. And they have been sent to Bigelow, where there is the flow cytometer facility for single cell separation. And then they identify the sacs, and this is for protists. Then if we look at the phototrophic source, then the nice thing with the flow cytometer is that you can separate the microbes depending on several properties. And one property is the presence of chlorophyll. Then if you target protists, you can sort heterotrophic protists because they do not have chlorophyll. And phototrophic proteins that they have a chloroplast. Then in this project, they sorted the two assemblages independently. And with the phototrophic source, you can see all the list of different things that appear. And with the heterotrophic source, again, the list of the different phylogenetic groups that are represented in this sex. Then to put that into the context of the previous tag sequencing analysis, again, this is the figure that we saw before. And here, I just pointed the groups that are represented by the phototrophic source. And those are the groups that you would expect to find, and including some groups that were in culture, like the mouse. Again, the mouse here. And this is the phototrophic source. And when you put the groups for the heterotrophic source, also all the mast that appear here now appear in the sacs, and they are presented. Then what I would say from this image is that I was totally surprised and amazed to see how efficient was the sorting process. Then really sorting phototrophs and heterotrophs, you are really separating almost 100% the cells. Then the very, very good representation. And also it's a very good coverage of protein diversity. Then basically we have now representatives of the genomes of almost everything that is present in environmental samples for protists. Another thing that you can do with these sacs is try to do population genetics. And population genetics, you normally have a population, you have several individuals, you choose several markers, and then you try to see what is the variability in this population and compare with other populations. Then I think now we can take this population, this cell, this cell, this cell, to take several cells from the same group or the same species, see the variability in this assemblage compared with other things. Then for the mass four group that I explained before, that it is such a distributed and abundant group of heterotrophic protists, we have 66 different sacs that comes from different sites and that represent all the different clades within the group. Then we have really a very nice material to investigate a little bit more the species concept and perhaps population genetics of this protist population that still is not culture. And we tried to culture, but we have not been successful. And finally, this is an example of a metagenomic recruitment using the genome of one of the sacs. This is 10 million base pairs. This is a mass four. The genome comes with different pieces. And then we put all the pieces together and we arrive to 10 million base pairs. Probably it's a fraction of the genome, but we don't know the genome size of this organism. And here are the different metagenomic reads. Here it's you see each color is a different sample. Then you see that this genome that we have sequenced by SAC sequencing is a good way to recruit metagenomic reads. Because to interpret metagenomics, one of the main problems is that you don't have reference genomes. Then one of the aims of this approach is to get and construct reference genomes to identify the metagenomic reads of eukaryotes. Okay. And now I'm coming to the end of the talk, just highlighting a few points. I will start saying that the environmental sequencing has really opened a new window for microbial exploration. As I said before, we couldn't choose to use that or not. We were forced to apply this approach to understand more this component. And probably these three things are very important to remember. One is that the phylogenetic diversity of microbes in the sea is very high. There are many different things and many different different taxonomic levels. Also that this diversity is formed in a very significant part by things that are not that are not represented in culture, and many of them form novel lineages that were unknown before. And also it has helped to identify novel functions in the ocean. Then obviously the next generation sequencing, which is the reason why we are here, to explore the potential of this approach, in this case, for me, for microbial ecology, is facilitating this exploration and is the way to go the present day. It's more, you get more, cheaper and faster sequencing. And with that, you can have a better tools and better data to compare communities at the phylogenetic level, at the functional level. You can even detect genes that could be novel and important, but they are at low abundance. And also you can enter to the rare biosphere and try to identify it and to make some sense of it. Another thing that I want to say is that now we are sequencing a lot. We are getting data from genomes, from cultured organisms, genomes of sacs, things that are isolated by flow cytometry. We are getting metagenomes. And everything that it's obtained now, it's going to be very much exploited in the future. I'm sure about that. Because now perhaps you can give an initial description of what you have, but there is so much information that is there that somebody that is interested in a specific pathway, they can go and exploit all this data. Then I think it's going to be very interesting for the future to identify, and there are thousands of histories that you can investigate using this data. And this is the current challenges. This is a little bit naive from my part because this is not really my experience, but I think assembly, I think it's really an issue. It's a very challenging issue to get good assembles. Basically, and most, I mean, if it is a problem when you have a genome, it's even much more a problem when you have a metagenome, because in a genome you expect to have a single or perhaps two copies of the same. But in a metagenome you have a lot of different things that are everything mixed together. You have a lot of genomes that are mixed in the community. And then of course the computers, the storage and the power, and then obviously the bioinformatic people, brains and tools that are necessary to make some sense with this data that it's getting. Yes, it's coming soon. And I'm ending with some acknowledgments of the people that participate in this work, especially people in Bigelow that have done the single cell genomics. And do you want me to present? Because I have been asked to present a project. Shall I do it now or?
Yes, we have one small, well, few slides about the marine genomics for users, right?
Yes.
Because he's one of our sponsors, so just a couple of slides, I think.
Okay. Then basically, when these people knew that I was coming here, they asked me if I could present this data. And then I'm not participating in this project, but I talked with them. They explained it to me. This is it's an action project from the European Union, and basically, is a project that tries to promote the knowledge transfer of marine genomic information to the end users. And that's the main aim of the project. Here is an explanation of the consortium. There are five high-quality research public institutes and two private institutions. And the project started last year, and it's going to end next year in 2013. And as I said before, this project, this coordination action, is set up to promote the knowledge transfer in the field of marine genomics to the general scientific community, industry, public authorities, and other potential users. Basically, it's trying, it was born in the, this is the sixth program framework in European Union, the marine genomics. and that was the seed of this project, and then tries to promote this transfer of knowledge. And here is a little bit how it's organized. It has three phases. The first phase is to collect and understand, then to collect all the data that it's getting in different places of marine genomics at all different levels, genomes, metagenomes, in different organisms related to the sea. Then the second level is to analyze this data and see how you can change it and digest it to make it accessible to the end users, which can be both researchers, industries, or public agencies. And finally, the third level is to transfer this information to these end users. And I think that's the most important thing what I have to say, which is the web page and the person to contact, the project manager. Then if you have any question, you can access that. In this web page, it's going to be released soon, the work that has been done in this project.